Welcome. Early arrivers, the music you've been listening to is Icarus by Paul Winter of Winter Consort. It's 4 p.m. Welcome all. It's wonderful to see folks who were here last week, plus many new ones. By the way, we're recording each of the six units except for the conversations in the breakout rooms. Information on where to watch the recordings will be at the Eventbrite link you use to register. While waiting for the less punctual, let's learn better who we are today by using some anonymous polls. You'll recognize them. The polls will come up in the middle of your Zoom screen for about 20 seconds each. Each poll will allow only one answer among the many. Don't forget they're anonymous. Let's do the polls. Age. Now, I'm not seeing the actual polling. Last time it was like watching popcorn. It takes a while to get going, and then there's a lot of fierce popping. And then there's just a few kernels at the bottom that come in, and that's when I stop it and look at the summary of the results. So I'd like to look at the results now. I'm gonna take a picture of this. By the way, this is one of those events where your cameras, you can have them out and use them. In fact, if you see a slide that interests you, take a picture of it. Then you'll have it when you need it. That's particularly true in our speakers' slides. There are a lot of good ones. Wow. Well, we've gotten a little bit younger, which is a rare thing to do. So that's good. But we're still a lot of people who are looking back and saying, wow, I've got to do more for the next generations. Thank you. Okay, where are we from? Let's look at that poll. Where do we live now? And I'm not seeing the results, but I'd like to share them with everybody. Wow, 5% outside of New England. Well, those outside of New England, please, who live outside of New England, please raise your hand in the reactions tab at the bottom of the screen. Little to the right middle, reactions. Raise your hand and we can unmute a couple of you. We don't unmute you. We give you permission to unmute. You have to unmute yourself. But if you want to identify where you're from, here's your chance.
I'm from Colorado.
Great. My college roommate was talking to him last night. Anybody else raising their hand? All right, we're going to move on to the next question, which is engagement. We're hoping a couple people may have even changed their engagement since last week. Thank you. I'm getting to see the popcorn pop now. It's slowed down, so we'll end the poll and start to share. Is this being shared? Good. Well, as we noticed last week, an awful lot of if we only had the whole population like this, our leaders and policies would be much more enlightened. That's for sure. That's terrific. Although we really want to bring in folks who aren't in the choir yet. That's for sure. Okay. Thank you all who entered the poll. While we were polling, the number of participants has grown. And so that worked. For those who just arrived, we've been doing the polls and they basically say, most of us were from New England, if not really locally, but a few are about five or further away, including Colorado. We found that we're, well, sort of early middle age and then older, mostly, most of us. And then we found that a lot of involvement. A few people aren't sure what to do and they're pressed with other priorities. There are plenty of other things to think about, especially at times like this week. But still about half of us are doing things individually and among those people, a lot of them have moved on to also doing things with groups in order to make an impact on their community or their workplace or their church. Or their local government or their state government. Welcome to all. Thank you for coming. My name is Phil Coonley, a member I'm going to share results, a member of Mass 350. Somehow I'm getting nothing but the poll. Okay, it's gone. 350 Mass Metro North node of, and also of the Winchester Unitarian Society's Green Sanctuary Committee, the groups which developed this seminar. You can see that in slide one. These two organizations were joined in promoting the event by the eight other organizations listed. Thank you to each of these groups. They're all active in furthering environmental responsibility among themselves, at their work or their worship places, and among policymakers, especially at the municipality and state levels of government. Thanks also to the many individuals who organized this event or facilitated its production. And I want you to especially thank James Shung, our patient and skilled Zoom producer. He's a full-time freshman at UConn, but he's still volunteering many hours helping older folks like me get our acts together. Everyone involved has done more than any of us realized would be needed. This is our second time out, but our goal is still more about connection than perfection. And finally, the entire team offers special appreciation to our nine fabulous speakers. Mark Sandine last week for the Lexington Select Board, Ken Pruitt today from the Winchester Sustainability Director, Cora Weisbord, Mothers Out Front, Ingrid Geis, Alan Field, Roger Rosen, a panel from 350 Mass Metro North, John Waukee from Green Roots, and Emily Hitchcock and Charlie Hitchcock, Sunrise Movement. Really lucky to have them. Our hope for this seminar is for the six 90-minute programs to leave each of you with three things. The first is realistic hope, that notwithstanding the seriousness of the climate crisis that human behavior has already caused and is still accelerating, There are sound reasons to know it can be solved in ways that are both surprisingly practical and benign. As Rumi said, ours is no caravan of despair. The second thing we want all to have is a better understanding of impactful actions one can take now, especially at the individual, local, and state levels. The third thing we hope is that you will leave with pathways to connections with others. Working in a group of congenial people can be far more effective than working alone, and thus more satisfying, and sometimes even fun. Each of our six units begins with a short video from Drawdown's Climate Solutions 101, all narrated by Jonathan Foley, Executive Director of Project Drawdown. Some of you know of Project Drawdown's book. It's really worth looking at. It speaks succinctly and factually to 80 already proven solutions that could together, more like silver buckshot than a silver bullet, together make the world reach drawdown, the point when levels of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere stop climbing and start to steadily decline and reach it before 2050, only 30 years from now, if we really would accelerate good things that are already happening. Our program today begins with the second video in the Climate Solutions 101 series, Stopping Climate Change. After we watch the video, we will all meet in small breakout rooms to share our thoughts. We'll then have a brief report from each group via chat. Next, we will have the pleasure of listening to today's speaker, Ken Pruitt, a longtime climate activist who is now Winchester's Sustainability Director. Following his talk, Ken will answer your questions. Then after a preview of next week's program and a request for some feedback from you, we'll wrap up by 5:30 with a short music video. After that, the Zoom site will stay open for another 10 minutes for those wanting to ask for or give information. Okay, let's get going with screening of the 17-minute video, Stopping Climate Change.
Okay, so now we're going to look at how we can stop climate change and achieve what we call drawdown. Stopping climate change is necessary if we want to have a better future, because everything we do is connected back to climate change. Our water, our food, our air, our health, our security, our economy are all connected to what happens to weather and climate. So if we don't fix climate change, all the other things we care about in the future are going to be a lot harder. So we need to address climate change in order to have a better future with a prosperous economy, with resilience, equity, justice, and creativity, all the things we want demand that we address climate change. And that's what we're about. I work for something called Project Drawdown, which is the world's leading resource for climate solutions. We focus on the science we need to know to address climate change and then share it with the world. But why do we use that word drawdown? What does that even mean? Well, drawdown refers to a point in time in the future, and it refers to the greenhouse gas levels in the atmosphere. Now, remember I told you in the last unit, greenhouse gases have been building up in the atmosphere. Here we are today at the 2020 levels. But then we can choose what happens next. On the path we're on now, we'll just continue to build up these gases, which will just warm the planet more, making the problem worse. But we don't have to do that. We can bend the curve. Bending the curve on climate change means reversing the curve of growing greenhouse gases. And when we hit this point, the little blue dot here, that's the moment of drawdown. That's the moment when greenhouse gases stop climbing and they begin to go back down again into a healthier place. So drawdown is the moment in the future when greenhouse gas levels stabilize and stop climbing, and then they start to steadily decline. And that's when we begin to stop climate change. At Project Drawdown, our job is to get the world to drawdown as quickly, safely, and equitably as possible. So how do we get there? Well, first, we're gonna have to learn a little bit of science. It won't be too hard, but it's the stuff we really do need to know to kind of get forward on climate solutions. So first of all, what are greenhouse gases? Well, you've heard a little bit about this before, I'm sure. You know that greenhouse gases kind of let in the sun's heat and they trap the Earth's heat as Earth is radiating out into outer space. So essentially they trap heat, and the more gases means the more heat. And that's why the planet's warming up. Pretty simple. There's a little bit more to it. It turns out that Earth already had greenhouse gases before we came along. There were natural greenhouse gases like water vapor, a little bit of carbon dioxide, and a few other things that have been there for millions, if not billions, of years of Earth history. But then we've got these things we call anthropogenic greenhouse gases, or human-caused greenhouse gases that we've been adding on top of that. And those include more carbon dioxide than was there before, more methane, more nitrous oxide. We've added chemicals that weren't even in the atmosphere before, like fluorinated gases, so-called chlorofluorocarbons, hydrofluorocarbons, and so on, and many other gases that are impacting our climate. And we can actually see how they've been rising over the last 100, 200 years, and especially in the last few decades. We have changed the nature of Earth's atmosphere and added a human greenhouse effect on top of natural greenhouse effect. And that's where we're getting into trouble. So what do these do? It's actually really simple physics. The idea is greenhouse gases are transparent. They let solar radiation, visible light, what we can see, right through them, like just a window. You can see right through it. But in infrared radiation, which you and I can't see, it is opaque. The infrared radiation is what Earth gives off to the rest of the universe, and so it can trap that heat in the atmosphere. It kind of works like this. Imagine a version of Earth with no atmosphere at all, like the moon. It would absorb the sun's radiation and warm up. The sun's heating the ground and the ground would warm up. The ground, just obeying the laws of physics, would also give off heat or infrared radiation back to the rest of the universe, out to outer space. And without an atmosphere, this is what it would look like. The sun's heat comes in, Earth's heat goes out, and they'd be in perfect balance, and we'd be at a temperature that would be accordingly in balance with that. But now let's add an atmosphere, a natural atmosphere. So we have what was the natural greenhouse effect. The idea is as Earth is radiating its heat out into outer space, some of it would be absorbed by the air above it. And some of that would then be re-radiated back down towards the Earth's surface. That has the effect of making the Earth's surface a little bit warmer and the upper atmosphere a little bit colder. And that's exactly what Earth has had. And so are mainly all the other planets. Venus, Mars, and others also have a greenhouse effect kind of like that. But then humans come along and we add some more of those gases to the atmosphere. Be like adding another blanket on your bed in the wintertime. It traps more heat and keeps you toastier, a little bit warmer, and so on. And so this enhanced greenhouse effect traps a little bit more heat, radiates a little bit more down, and it warms the surface even more. And so far, we've warmed the planet about 1 degree Celsius. That doesn't sound like a lot, but think about it. During the last ice age, the planet as a whole was only 3 degrees colder than normal, and it was a totally different planet. This place was under about a mile of ice, in fact. We've warmed the planet in the other direction by about 1 degree so far, and we're gonna keep going. If we keep going to another 2, 3, or 4 degrees, that could be a world we wouldn't even recognize. It would be very, very dangerous for our civilization. So where do these gases come from? Well, I'm sure you've already heard that a lot of them come from burning fossil fuels, right? Burning oil and natural gas and coal and petroleum substitutes and all these things that we have. And that is part of the story. Burning fossil fuels does create CO2. And that causes about 62% of the warming we see on the planet today. So if you forget about everything else, fossil fuels cause more than half of climate change. But that's not all. It turns out that CO2 is also produced by a few other things, including chemistry. In fact, a lot of our industrial processes, especially making cement, releases CO2 into the atmosphere without burning anything at all. It's just kind of industrial chemistry. We also release a lot of CO2 into the atmosphere by burning down trees and deforestation. This green area shows you how much CO2 is caused by burning down forest, which is kind of like burning coal. Coal's dead, trees are alive, but they're both made out of carbon. And you burn them in our atmosphere, you will make carbon dioxide either way. Then we have our next greenhouse gas of methane. Methane is produced by a whole bunch of different things, but the two big sources are agriculture and industry. In agriculture, which is about two-thirds of this methane emissions, is caused largely from cattle. And you've heard all the jokes before, I'm sure, about cow farts. Turns out that's not even true. Cows actually burp methane. They don't fart methane any more than other animals. The other third of this methane comes from industry, especially mining natural gas. Gas wells, fracking, gas pipelines, even coal mines release methane as well. So we have to think about energy and industry and agriculture to look at methane. Then we've got this stuff called nitrous oxide, which a lot of people don't even think about, but it's a big part of our climate change equation. And nitrous oxide, some of that comes from industry, but again, a lot of it comes from agriculture, especially using too much fertilizer or too much manure on our farmers' fields. And finally, we have F gases, or fluorinated gases, which are chemicals we use as refrigerants and sometimes as insulators in industrial processes. And those refrigerants, like chlorofluorocarbons and hydrofluorocarbons, are rising dramatically, and that's why we have to pay attention to this. So putting all those gases together, we emit about 52 gigatons of the equivalent of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere each year. What the heck is a gigaton? It's just a fancy word for a billion metric tons. So we emit 52 billion metric tons of pollution into the atmosphere every year. But there are only 7.5 billion of us. So on average, we're emitting many, many tons of pollution per person into the atmosphere. That's a huge amount. And we're gonna talk more about that and how we can cut that down. Another thing we have to notice is that each of these gases works a little bit differently. Some gases trap more heat than others, like methane and nitrous oxide, and those fluorinated gases trap way more heat molecule for molecule than CO2 does. But some gases last longer in the atmosphere than others too, and we gotta take that into account. Like methane, we emit today, most of it will be gone within 10 to 20 years. CO2 we emit today will be in the air for centuries and centuries to come. So we have to look at the strength and lifetime of these different gases. In particular, when we think about methane, methane again is that part of the wedge of our whole diagram of greenhouse gases. If we look at the impact of today's emissions on climate for the next 100 years, methane will cause about 16% of that warming over a 100-year period. But if we look at the next 20 years instead, the role of methane doubles and becomes 32%. So it turns out in the near term, our climate changes are going to be caused by mainly methane and other gases, but in the long term, they're going to be dominated by things like CO2. So which gas we focus on depends a little bit on what time period of climate change you're really most concerned about. We have to look at all of them. Now that we understand what greenhouse gases are and kind of how they work, we're going to look at what regulates the level of those gases in the atmosphere, what makes them go up and what makes them go down. To do this, sometimes it's helpful to think of a bathtub. But imagine a bathtub which we can fill and empty with water. We do that every day, right? Pretty simple. When we add water to the bathtub by turning on the faucet, we scientists call that a source. It's a source of water, and it levels up the water in the bathtub. We can also remove water by opening up the drain, and scientists call that a sink. You'll hear that word a lot about sinks of greenhouse gases. The difference between the sources and the sinks determines whether the water goes up or the water goes down. Sources add and make the water go up. Sinks remove and makes the water go down. Now, if you have a bathtub with the faucet on and the drain open, we have an interesting picture. If the sources are bigger than the sinks, the water level will still go up. But if the drain, the sink, is bigger than the faucet, the source, the water levels will go back down again. So let's take that and apply it to Earth's atmosphere. Well, Earth's atmosphere is basically a big bathtub in the sky. We can fill it with pollution and greenhouse gases, the sources of greenhouse gases, which is largely due to us. And then we have sinks of greenhouse gases, things that pull that pollution out of the sky and put it someplace else. We have sinks on this planet of greenhouse gases, primarily in plants, on land, but also in the oceans. So here's the picture. We put pollution in the atmosphere, nature pulls it out in forests and in oceans. Now, right now, our sources of pollution, the stuff we're putting in the atmosphere, is much bigger than what nature can take out. And that's why the levels are going up. But what if we reduced our pollution? What if we brought it down by a half or so? Well, then maybe nature could kind of keep up with it and pull as much pollution out of the atmosphere as we're putting in. If that were to happen, we would hit that moment of drawdown and we'd stabilize CO2 levels and they'd stay flat. But we can go farther and actually reduce our pollution down to zero and pull more carbon and other stuff out of the atmosphere and actually have greenhouse gases decline and stop climate change and begin to reverse in the long term the damage we've done. So this balance between sources and sinks is what will determine the future of our planet and our climate. And let's look at the numbers. In today's atmosphere, we see that we actually have about six major sources of greenhouse gas pollution. We'll go into them later, but you see electricity and food, industry, transportation, buildings, and other stuff. Then we have nature, which on land and in the oceans pull out a total of about 41% of those greenhouse gases, primarily the carbon dioxide part. And that leaves behind 59% of those greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, building up year over year over year. So to achieve drawdown, to get them to reverse and bend the curve back down, we've got to work on both sides of this equation. We can work on the sources and bring them down to zero, kind of turning off that faucet over the coming decades, so there's no pollution there at all. And we can also work with the sinks of carbon, starting with the natural ones that already exist, and make sure they can continue to pull that stuff out of the sky. So the idea of getting the drawdown actually will be based on three big principles, and these are important. The first thing we've got to do, and we always need to begin here, is reduce the problem before it even starts. Let's stop pollution before it even gets in the atmosphere so it doesn't cause any problems at all. And that means bringing these emissions down to zero. So we're gonna have to zoom in and look at what causes these emissions, what's in the economy, what can we do about it in all of these different sectors, from electricity to industry to agriculture and beyond. And if we do that, we can cause a big reduction in these things and eventually bring them down to zero. So job number one, stop pollution, bring it to zero. Job number two will be working over in the nature space, basically supporting nature's carbon cycle and maybe even adding to it in the form of sinks. That's the right-hand side of this diagram. We'll have to zoom in here and look on land and oceans about what controls their ability to take up carbon and how can we support that and maybe even augment it, making it stronger in the future. So we've looked at the left-hand side and the right-hand side of that big picture, the sources, the sinks, and we know what to do. But there's a third area we've got to talk about too, and we'll get into this later, is about how, as we improve society, we can do things that aren't about climate change. They're things we should do anyway. But when we improve equality and equity and justice around the world, there are things we do there that actually have major secondary climate benefits. So we might get a twofer of improving human rights and equality and contributing to climate solutions. So working together, reducing pollution, supporting nature, and improving society are the three pillars of our climate solution space. Building on these three pillars and pulling them together all at the same time, we actually have all we need to address climate change in the coming decades. And this is going to be our job over the next few units of this course.
I've seen this video several times and my reaction differs each time. So it's likely that among you, there are many different thoughts about what you saw and heard. To explore these, you've been randomly assigned a small group breakout room. In the breakout room, please follow three guidelines. For those with memories as short as mine, the info in this slide will be placed. Actually, the information in this slide won't be, so take a picture of it, but the questions will be placed in your breakout room. The three guidelines: be sure everybody has an opportunity to speak and to be heard. Two, try both and thinking. More than one reality or perspective can be true at the same time. And three, know what others have said and build on each other's ideas. Once all, usually four, are in the breakout room, please first introduce yourself to your group and share a couple things about yourself. After these introductions, please discuss three questions. What brought you here today? What stood out most for you in the video? And three, if your small group were to share one consensus thought with the entire gathering, what would it be? You will be in the breakout room about 12 minutes. By the way, when you figured out in number three, what your thought would be, try to write it down succinctly in your chat, in your breakout room, and then copy it. Because when you go back to the main room, it's a different chat world. So we want you to take your message from your breakout room chat, copy it, and then paste it in the general room chat so we can all see it together and talk about it. You'll be in the breakout room about 12 minutes, and you're going to get a time reminder about every 3 minutes and the last 30 seconds. The time reminder will show up at the top middle of your Zoom screen. When you see the invite, please join your breakout room. Okay. Are people reading this? Wow. Well, I hope you can all read it. There's a lot of thoughts here. And they're optimistic ones. In our group, there was mostly optimism, but someone said they really believe in being part of a group because it's the issues are so overwhelming and that it's good to have comrades around when you're on the downside and they're on the upside. It kind of keeps you going. And then one example that I gave in our group, which wasn't given about the win-win opportunities was educating girls, which is women, young women, was like number six of all the 80 things that are out there that are happening now that really make a difference. And number seven was family planning. And together they are bigger than any single one of the technologies, you know, offshore wind or whatever your favorite one is. And that was an example of the societal, of things that benefit society, but also have tremendously beneficial environmental effects. And not only are the women who are educated and had family planning, having smaller families that they tend to spend their money more on the families than on some of the things guys spend it on. But because they're more educated, they're able to adapt better to new technologies, new ways of farming and whatever. Anyway, that's an example. A lot of good things here. Okay, we're gonna now move on to our speaker. Wait a second here. It's now my honor to introduce today's guest speaker, Ken Pruitt. Ken earned his master's degree from the Yale School of the Environment and then spent 3 years working on environmental projects as a contractor for the U.S. Department of Energy and the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. 5 years as director of conservation for the town of Boxford, 5 years as executive director of the Massachusetts Association of Conservation Commissions, 5 years as managing director and then executive director of the Environmental League of Massachusetts, and 4 years as the town of Arlington's energy manager, where he led town efforts in energy efficiency, renewable energy, electric vehicle acquisition, and climate change planning. This fall, Ken was selected as Winchester's first sustainability director. During Ken's talk, please write any questions you have as they come up in the chat box addressed to me. I'll ask them of Ken afterwards. He's going to leave some time at the end to answer many questions. Welcome, Ken.
Well, thanks so much, Phil. This is a great series that you and others have put together. I watched the recording from last week. It was excellent, and I'm looking forward to participating in the rest of the series. And thanks everyone for coming today and for your interest and concern about climate change and how to solve the climate crisis. Let me switch over to my slides at this point. Let's see. Minimize that. So one thing I will say also is that I think it probably is a good idea to hold questions to the end. However, if there is something that just isn't clear and it seems like it's an important point that I've said something and people are confused, for something like that, feel free, Phil, to jump in and ask me to clarify, just so that we don't have people sort of scratching their heads for the rest of the presentation. So I'm going to start off. I want to make sure I can do this. There we go. Starting off with actually going back in time a little bit, instead of starting with today, Winchester has a long track record of taking climate action. In 2005, the town formed what's called the Energy Management Committee that still is in operation today. I saw Susan McPhee, one of the founders and still a member, as one of our participants today. And that committee is focused on reducing energy use in Winchester's municipal buildings and has done a great job doing so. In 2010, Winchester was designated a green community by the Department of Energy Resources based on the town committing to several energy-related, energy and climate-related metrics. Also in 2010, the Select Board established a Climate Action Task Force. That task force created the town's first greenhouse gas inventory based on 2006 data. In 2011, the town's first climate action plan was completed, calling for a 15% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions by 2016 and an 80% reduction by 2050. The Climate Action Advisory Committee was formed, which still exists today, and which I know a number of members of are on this call. In 2017, the Wind Power Green Electricity Aggregation Program was launched, and I'll say more about that later in my presentation. 2019, we ran the Heat Smart Arlington Winchester campaign to promote clean heating and cooling technologies like heat pumps and solar hot water. The Select Board formally committed the town to an 80% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions by 2050, which really has been superseded now by state law, I'm happy to say, that's calling for legally requiring 100% reduction by 2050. We also completed a greenhouse gas inventory based on 2017 data, which I'll say more about later in the presentation. In 2020, we completed a new climate action plan that matched the Select Board's 2019 commitment, so 80% GHG reduction by 2050. More about the climate action plan in a moment. The town received a grant from the Metropolitan Area Planning Council to hire a sustainability director and to undertake a few projects. 2021, the Select Board adopted a heat statement calling for a series of steps to prepare for future heat waves. And town meeting voted to fund the creation of the sustainability director position. And in fact, the sustainability director was hired, and that is me. And I started on October 12th last year. Just briefly, I talked about the town's climate commitment, the state climate commitment, a couple of big highlights. 2008, the Global Warming Solutions Act, major step forward, called for a reduction of 25% greenhouse gas emissions by 2020 and 80% by 2050. In 2020, we moved as a state to a 100% reduction of greenhouse gas emissions by 2050 target administratively through the Baker administration. And then in 2021, the landmark Next Generation Roadmap was passed by the legislature, putting into state law a 100% greenhouse gas reduction by 2050 requirement with sub-targets earlier than that. So let's talk about greenhouse gas emissions from Winchester. In 2017, we were responsible for 175,000 metric tons of CO2 equivalent. You know what CO2 equivalent is from having just watched that drawdown video. We have about 23,000 residents and 7,000 buildings, works out to about 7.6 tons of greenhouse gas emissions per resident. Like most towns in the region, it's more or less 60-40. Buildings and transportation with small amounts from other sources. And we're a overwhelmingly residential town. 76% of those greenhouse gas emissions were from the residential sector, 18% from commercial, 3% from municipal, and 3% other. As I mentioned, we adopted a climate action plan in 2020 that called for, as I mentioned, reduction of 80% greenhouse gas emissions by 2050 from energy supply, our energy supply, buildings, transportation sector, and solid waste. The other major component of the Climate Action Plan was to increase community resiliency to climate change, heat and drought, intense storms, and flooding. Today, because we're focused on reducing greenhouse gas emissions, that's going to be the focus of my talk and not the resilience component of the Climate Action Plan. So this is an extremely important slide. So if you're scrolling through your iPhone, just look up for a moment, at least for this part. There's three key strategies in our climate action plan to solving the climate crisis. And they are first to maximize energy efficiency in buildings. Second, to electrify everything, buildings and transportation. And third, to use carbon-free electricity, which we can do by advocating for an increase in what's called a renewable portfolio standard, the state requirement for minimum renewable electricity in our supply. And we can green Winchester's electricity supply locally by, you know, putting solar panels on roofs and signing and through our green aggregation program called Wind Power. This is key. So maximizing energy efficiency, electrifying everything and using carbon-free electricity. It's similar to the formula that Mark Sandeen mentioned last week, but he used, you know, slightly different terms. But the point is, if our buildings are efficient enough to be heated and cooled efficiently with essentially heat pumps, the only energy being used in buildings is electricity, and that electricity is coming from renewable sources or carbon-free sources, we will essentially be eliminating greenhouse gas emissions from the town of Winchester. These same three strategies are also usable in your everyday life for even if you don't live in Winchester, if you're a resident, if you work in a company that has a building or a fleet, these three strategies will get us to net zero, at least in Winchester. You know, as we saw, agriculture and other sources are really important, in agricultural states and countries and things like that. But in terms of Winchester, these three strategies are the main focus of our climate action plan. So what does energy efficiency mean? I'm sure you all know, but just to state the obvious, air sealing so buildings aren't leaky, and insulating walls and attics and roofs, very important to hold that warmth or cool in, which reduces the need for heating and air conditioning. I'm going to mention the home energy rating system here, which some of you are probably familiar with. It's a measurement of the energy efficiency of homes. When it was established in 2006, the reference home had a HERS rating of 100. At present, the average new home, at least in 2020, was achieving a HERS index score of 51. Winchester is a stretch energy code community. We've adopted the stretch energy code like most communities in the state, which currently requires a HERS rating of 55. Starting 2023, that requirement for stretch code communities should drop to HERS 42, which is substantially more efficient. It can be 45 if the building is all electric. That's the current draft anyway. So a state energy code is getting stronger. It's also a potential opt-in specialized code, but that's beyond the scope of what we have time to talk about today. A couple of things we're also doing locally. In 2009, Winchester adopted an energy efficient building policy, primarily focused on making buildings LEED Silver. We're looking to update and fully revise that this year. My prediction is that we'll be requiring all new municipal buildings to be at least net zero ready, which means essentially all electric. And we're putting that into practice even before we have the new policy. the new Lynch Elementary School will have an EUI or energy use intensity of 25 or lower. That is super, super efficient, close to the passive house standard. And it means that it'll be easy to heat and cool with heat pumps. And in fact, we have a commitment at this point from the town to build that building to be all electric and super efficient and potentially even net zero, but we'll, it's a bridge we'll cross as we go through development. So how does the town promote energy efficiency? We have an informational website. I'll show you, which I'm actually building at present. I'll show you a slide about that in a minute. And part of what is on the town website are links to sort of a curated list of what we think are the best online resources for a variety of things, including energy efficiency. The Mass Clean Energy Center's Clean Energy Lives Here website is an example, tremendous website. We also include information on the Mass Save program. It's run by the utilities. If you haven't had a free Mass Save energy audit of your home recently, you should do so. You're then eligible for heavily subsidized insulation and air sealing work if needed on your home, and rebates on efficient heating systems and other appliances. The town also periodically runs campaigns to promote energy efficiency. The Heat Smart campaign that I mentioned that we ran in 2019 included promotion of home energy audits, for example. The town is also leading by example. I mentioned earlier our Energy Management Committee, which has been very effective at reducing energy use from municipal buildings. I mentioned the website that I'm leading the development of right now. You see the link there, but don't worry about writing it down. The final slide in this presentation has a list of important links, including this one. But this website is intended to be sort of a one-stop shopping location where you can find either information or links to very helpful information on all topics related to climate change. And so I recommend you take a look at that. It's under construction. It'll be getting better and better over time. It includes the key three that I mentioned, make buildings energy efficient, electrify everything, and obtain or use only clean electricity. It also has information on how to improve the energy efficiency and electrify buildings, transportation, our electricity supply. It has information on recycling and composting and also climate resilience. So on the point of electrifying everything, how do you do that? It means you instead of natural gas or oil heating, you heat your home with heat pumps. You heat your hot water with either solar hot water, which you see an example of a rooftop solar hot water system in the bottom left-hand corner of the screen, or a hot water heat pump. Cooking, natural gas is not only a greenhouse gas, but it also creates indoor air pollution. I know Mark Sandine commented on that last week. Either induction stoves or electric resistance eliminate that pollution. Induction stoves are also superior in essentially every way to gas stoves. A clothes dryer, either a heat pump or electric resistance clothes dryer. Landscaping equipment, either corded or battery. These are ways that you can switch all of your energy use at home to exclusively electrical. On heat pumps, because they are so important, just a couple of examples. The two key types are air source heat pumps and ground source heat pumps. Air source heat pumps have lower upfront cost. You can see the outdoor unit to an air source heat pump in the center of the screen. You can see in a ductless mini split head at the upper right-hand corner of the screen. They are a little bit less efficient when it's cold outside compared to a ground source heat pump, but they still do work and produce heat all the way down to minus 13 degrees, which feels very cold to our bodies, but it's way above the minus 486 or whatever it is, Kelvin, absolute zero. Plenty of heat in the air to run a heat pump even during the winter. There's both ducted versions where you use your existing forced hot air or central AC ducts, and ductless units where, and you see the ductless head in the upper right-hand corner. Ground source heat pumps have higher upfront cost, significantly higher, but they're very efficient year-round, less expensive to operate. You will recoup your money. Generally, only ducted options are offered as far as I can tell. But those are, if you can switch your home heating from either oil or natural gas or propane to either an air source or ground source heat pump, you will be taking a tremendous step to decarbonizing your home. These things are complex, and I'm covering them at a grossly superficial level. The website that I'm helping to build for the town has more information, and there are a variety of websites that do as well. The Mass Clean Energy Center's Clean Energy Lives Here website is particularly excellent. If you go and visit one website other than the Winchester's sustainability website after this webinar, I recommend you plan to spend some time at the Clean Energy Lives Here website. It's excellent. This is a great time to electrify your home. The MassSave program that we all pay for through our utility bills, that's run by the utilities, just came out with a new 3-year plan from 2022 to 2024. Incentives have increased. If you convert your home to an air source heat pump, you can get $10,000 towards the cost of that, which is in many cases going to be more than half the cost of doing so, depending on whether you have duct work or not in your home. If you want to convert to a ground source heat pump, you can get $15,000 towards that. You can now, this is another change, is you can still maintain a fossil fuel backup if you're worried about or need to maintain that. But you'll get a little bit lower incentive, and you have to have integrated controls that switch back and forth between your heat pump and the fossil fuel source, depending on the outside temperature. These incentives are now available even if your home is heated with gas. That's also a new change. You can also get rebates through the MassSave program for insulation and air sealing, as I mentioned earlier, for other efficient appliances like heat pump water heaters and dryers, programmable thermostats, and incentives if you're actually building a new house. A link to the MassSave website is on the last slide of this presentation. So electrifying everything isn't just your homes. It's also importantly transportation, which is, again, it's 36% of greenhouse gas emissions in Winchester. Couple of points on electric vehicles, quote unquote electric vehicles. A battery electric vehicle is a vehicle that has its source of propulsion is only a battery. A plug-in hybrid electric vehicle has a battery that drives the vehicle, but only for a certain distance, anywhere between 15 and 50 miles, depending on the model, before the gasoline engine kicks in. It's a good alternative for people who are a little queasy about making the full jump to a battery electric vehicle. No reason to not get a plug-in hybrid, because then no matter how far you're driving, you're guaranteed not to get stuck. But of course, charging stations are popping up along all the highways now. So really a BEV is I think there's no reason not to get one, honestly. EVs are a little bit more expensive on average than an internal combustion engine vehicle, but all the experts are predicting that within the next 2 to 3 years max, the starting price of an electric vehicle will be comparable to internal combustion engine vehicles of the same class. And they're already less expensive to drive and maintain. Anywhere from 50% to 2/3 the cost of gasoline per mile driven. And there's much less to maintain, less than half the cost to maintain an electric vehicle than an internal combustion engine vehicle. Something like 20 moving parts in the drivetrain of an electric vehicle compared to 200 moving parts in the drivetrain of an internal combustion engine vehicle, much less to maintain. And tons of models are coming very soon, including the Ford F-150 pickup truck is going to be electric next year. If you want to learn more about EVs, this coming March 9th at 7 p.m., I'm going to be helping to lead an EV 101 webinar. It's free, and details on how to register again will be on the final slide. Another great source of information on electric vehicles, the Green Energy Consumers Alliance has a Drive Green website where you can learn about electric vehicles, where you can find deals. Not as much right at the moment because of the supply chain crunch and chip shortage. But this is where I have leased an electric vehicle through and recently purchased. Fantastic website. Link is on the final slide. I have a 2021 Chevy Bolt battery electric vehicle. There it was in my driveway this morning charging. I purchased it through the Green Energy Consumers Alliance Drive Green discount program. I made my purchase at Quirk Chevrolet, a participating dealer. Only paid after the incentives, I paid $21,000 for this car that with an MSRP of $37,000. That was kind of a quirk, but if you keep your eyes open and visit the Drive Green website periodically, you might luck out as I did. I also then installed a $600 Clipper Creek Level 2 charging station. You can see it on the wall of my house right there. I did have to also spend $900 to have electricity brought out to that location, but that was because it had to go from the furthest possible point in my house through highly challenging logistics. Most people spend, you know, $200 to $400 on their electrician to install a charging station. So most people will charge at home, as I'm able to do, but not everyone can if you live in an apartment building, a condo, for example. So there is also public charging. There are 6 level 2 charging stations or charging ports in Winchester, more coming and many more in surrounding communities. And there are 4 DC fast charging stations coming to be owned by the town. If you look in the bottom right corner of the screen, that is a DC fast charging station, charges much faster than a level 2 charging station, 7 times as fast, more of a gas station type experience to charge. Great for people who live in an apartment building or a condo, for example. They're starting to proliferate around the state because of the federal infrastructure law. And also a Department of Environmental Protection Electric Vehicle Incentive Program, DC Fast Grant, that is gonna cause the construction of the installation of 306 DC Fast stations across Massachusetts over the next couple of years in 150 locations. How do you find a charging station? Number of good apps. I think PlugShare is the best. You can get it on your iPhone. You can look at it on the computer. That's an image from PlugShare that you see at the bottom of the screen showing charging stations in and around Winchester. So building energy efficiency, electrify everything, and then use carbon-free electricity. We're now on the third part of the key three. Winchester is advocating for an increase in the Massachusetts Renewable Portfolio Standard. That's the state law requiring a minimum amount of electricity supplied to Massachusetts businesses and residences to be renewable. It's currently this year at 20% class one renewables, which is the best kind, primarily solar and wind and hydro. That 20% is gonna increase 2% each year through 2024. And then it will go up to 3% per year from 2025 to 2029. So 40% total by 2030. Currently, unless the law has changed, it'll drop down to 1% per year starting 2031, which would only get us to 60% class one renewables by 2050, which is not enough. That's why we're working on advocacy with our legislative delegation. But the good news is, the grid is already about 50% non-carbon emitting. One reason is nuclear power. That chart on the right is from the ISO New England website. I did a screen grab yesterday at 2:03 p.m. And as you can see, 33% of our power supply was coming, electricity supply was coming from nuclear power. 12%, really, if you include hydro, 20% from renewables, and you can see the rest, mostly from, the rest is mostly natural gas. So we're getting there. Our grid is not as dirty as a lot of people think, even at present. In addition to that, we're working hard to increase the renewable electricity supply in town through the Wind Power Green Aggregation Program, which was launched in 2017. The default has 10% additional class one renewables than required by state law, which is 20%. So 30% altogether of Winchester's default supply is renewables. There are 5,829 subscribers at that level. It's almost everyone. We also have a Wind Power 100 product, which is 100% renewable electricity with 255 subscribers and hopefully growing. Looking ahead, this is a busy slide. Don't get too bogged down. Just note that the percentage of renewable energy, even if Winchester doesn't change the percentage of extra class one renewable energy in wind power, we will still get up to almost 75% renewables by 2030 because the renewable portfolio standard is increasing over time. And we still have considerable non-emitting resources that don't count as class one, like nuclear power. So basically, good news. I mentioned the Wind Power 100 program. If you live in Winchester and are not a Wind Power 100 participant, as soon as this webinar is over, please sign up. There's a link to the Wind Power website on the last slide. Everyone should participate. I'm a participant. It means all of your electricity is sourced from renewables. And it makes a big difference. Even though only 255 Winchester residents participate in Wind Power 100, and almost 6,000 or over 6,000 don't. They participated at just the 10% level extra. Wind Power 100 participants are responsible for a quarter of all the renewable electricity being purchased through the program. So you make a big difference by being in Wind Power 100. Here's some of the ways that we have been advertising Wind Power 100 around town. Shout out to Spark Energy and Susan McPhee and Fritzy Nace. I don't know if they're still on the call, but they're doing a great job promoting this program for the town. Another way that you can green your electricity supply locally, put solar panels on your roof. There's several local installers. I also recommend the Energy Sage Solar Quote Aggregator website. A link to it is again on the last slide of my presentation. You can own or lease solar depending on your preference, either buy and own it with the upfront cost or have no upfront cost and just have another company put panels on the roof and you just get lower electricity rates. Bottom left-hand corner there is the Winchester Department of Public Works facility where we have put solar to help green Winchester's municipal electricity supply. Another option, what if you live in a condo, in an apartment, or your roof is shaded? You can do community solar. You're basically purchasing a share in a solar array that's off-site, often not even in the same town. And then you get either net metering credits or bill offsets. Don't worry about what that really means. Just you'd save on your electricity bill and also source a good deal of your electricity from renewable sources. The Mass Clean Energy Center has a great website on this otherwise somewhat complex topic. And as I keep saying, the link is on the last slide. And speaking of the last slide, we're finally here. So there are an infinite number of probably useful websites with information on climate change and how to green your home and your transportation. This is kind of the Ken Pruitt curated list, some of the very best sources that I have found. You'll note the top one is for just actually for an event that's coming up. It's not really a permanent source of information, but it's free and it should be fun and informational. In addition to that, there's the sustainability department website that I'm currently building, the wind power website where you can sign up for 100% renewables, the MassSave website for energy audits, insulation, and as I mentioned, rebates on clean heating and cooling technologies and appliances, the Green Energy Consumers Alliance Drive Green website where through which I got my Chevy Bolt, the Mass Clean Energy Center Clean Energy Lives Here website, one of the best I've seen anywhere with resources on everything to do with switching your home to clean energy sources. The Energy Sage Solar Quote Aggregator, it's used by a lot of communities, including Cambridge as an official website to direct to get people quotes on solar, and the Mass Clean Energy Center's community solar website at the bottom. I'm going to click out of this, but we'll go back to it. So don't panic if you're writing this down. And I will also send out my slides in a PDF version for Phil to share with all of you later. Okay, I don't know how much time there's left for questions, but there you have it.
Wow, and we have a lot of questions. That was terrific. Let me start the questions, and we're going to we will end the program, but we'll as I'm going to tell people, there's a little at 5:30 we'll end it, but there'll be a little music video. Then after that, we'll have another 10 minutes for people who have some burning questions. And some of the questions we might be able to answer by email, but I'm just going to start because there are a lot of good ones. Let's see. One of them has to do with sort of comparing and contrasting with Lexington. This is for the people here who were here last week. And they heard about the 10,000 100% green consumers in Lexington, for example. What is Winchester doing more of and less of?
Yeah, so the difference between the wind power program, the default wind power program in Winchester compared to Lexington's, the real difference is that we are at present, we source our default is an extra 10% class one renewable electricity from within New England. Lexington's default class one renewable electricity from within New England is 20%. So they're at 20%, we're at 10% as the default. However, they also, for their remaining 80% of electricity supply in their program, they source that, or they offset it with what are called renewable energy certificates from national wind power. So wind power outside of New England, it's electricity that does not find its way into the New England grid. It's still important. It's still a good thing that they're doing, but it's not changing electricity usage, you know, within Massachusetts or within Lexington or even New England. So it's a good thing to do, but it's not comparable to class one renewables. So the real difference between Lexington and Winchester is that 10% versus 20% of extra class one.
Okay, and that same, since you mentioned kind of long distance transmission, someone's saying that they've heard that electricity that has to be produced somewhere else and then distributed across transmission lines has significant losses. So is the net reduction in climate effect by electrifying things really as significant as being claimed?
Well, you know, transmission losses are important. It's one reason to have as much distributed renewable generation as possible. You know, if you have solar panels on your roof, the transmission is like 30 feet down to your, you know, down to your panels. So there's essentially no transmission losses. Transmission losses aren't that high, even from the large renewable generators. We're about to have a lot of offshore wind power, for example, constructed, and it's gonna play a major role in decarbonizing the electricity supply in New England. But you know, it does mean that you have to build more renewable generation to take into account that those losses. But at the end of the day, if you're producing all your electricity from renewable sources, you're not emitting greenhouse gases. Even with the transmission losses, you're still achieving what you set out to do.
Thank you. Another one is there a message for retrofitting heat pumps in older homes? It takes many units and it's rather expensive despite the rebates.
Older homes are a challenge. If you have existing ductwork for either forced hot air heating or for central AC, then you can usually use that same ductwork for a heat pump, for a central heat pump, and then you don't have to have all those mini split heads located all over the house, which is very expensive. If you don't have that and don't want to put in ductwork, the main option at present is our mini splits, and it can be very expensive. I don't have a great solution to that except to say, even if you do part of your home, you're reducing your greenhouse gas emissions because you're reducing the heating load from your existing fossil fuel heater. So maybe you just do your bedrooms, maybe you just do your living room. It's better than nothing. I am hoping that what are called air to water heat pumps improve in efficiency and in power and lower in cost, so that we can actually have a drop-in solution where you put an air source heat pump in a home and it uses the existing hydronic radiator system to heat the home, in which case you don't need to worry about ductwork and you're not putting mini split heads. You're just essentially putting in a new boiler, but it's a heat pump boiler. Where people are working on that.
Boy, that would have been a good thing for my home.
Yeah.
Now I've got both the heat pump and my old radiators. Question is here, how many years to get your operating money back if you use geothermal rather than the air source? In other words, how does that trade off?
Yeah, it depends on a few things. The bigger your home is, the bigger the heat pump system needs to be. You might need additional wells drilled, and the big cost for ground source heat pump systems are the wells. You know, you're drilling hundreds of feet down into the ground, so each well adds a substantial amount of cost. But you know, with this new $15,000 mass save rebate, that can really slash the cost down. You can then get, if you haven't done one before, what's called a heat loan through the state to generally pay for the remaining costs, so you don't have really any upfront cost. And you should save enough that you can pay off that loan entirely just with savings on your utility bills. I've seen anywhere from like 7 to 15 years to pay off geothermal systems, but that was before the $15,000 mass save rebate. So that might, you might be looking at 5 to 8 years at this point.
One last question, which is, what was the spark that first ignited your passion for climate action?
Yeah, I was very lucky to have, kind of an idyllic childhood in many ways, where I got to spend a lot of time in forests, playing around in wetlands and things like that. My family was really focused on outdoor activities, and I just spent a great deal of time in nature. Climate change was not even on my radar screen, until much later in life when I had already been working on other environmental issues, especially wetlands protection and, land use. And really, like the rest of us, once it was demonstrated that climate change was the existential threat to society and to the natural world, that became my primary interest in being a part of the solution.
Thank you, participants, for your great questions. There are lots of them. We'll come to some more of them if you stick around after our music video. just a short one. And Ken, thank you for informing us so well. You really have focused on the sources. You've really focused on what individuals can do. And you've provided some new information sources, at least for me, when it comes to understanding the economics of the above ground heat pumps. I'm looking forward to learning more about that. Next week, we're looking forward to seeing you back. We'll be doing the drawdown video, reducing sources. And that's what you've been hearing a lot about today. How do you reduce a source as an individual? In 24 minutes, it will discuss up-to-date methods for halting emissions before they reach the atmosphere. This unit walks through the five largest sources of greenhouse gases: electricity, food, industry, transportation, and buildings, bringing the path to a safer, low-carbon economy into sharper relief. Our guest speaker will be Cora Weisbord, volunteer from Mothers Out Front. Cora will share information about our emissions sources in Massachusetts and our state's climate goals, with a focus on buildings and natural gas. Cora will discuss Mothers Out Front's Clean Heat, Clean Air campaign and explain how to get involved in Mothers Out Front or other climate efforts at a level that is comfortable for you. Since you registered for this event, you are already registered for any of the next four events you wish to attend and via the same Zoom link. I hope you'll be here and bring a friend, colleague, or member of your family. Encourage them to prepare by watching, in this case, the first two videos. If you have feedback about today's unit, please put it in the chat as you listen to our music video, The Tide is Rising. And for those with more questions or comments to share with the team, we'll keep the Zoom open till 5:45. Have a great week. Thank you, Ken, and participants.
Thank you.
The tide is rising, and so are we. The tide is rising, and so are we. The tide is rising, and so are we. This is where we are called to be. This is where we are called to be. The task is mighty, and so are we. The task is mighty, and so are we. The task is mighty, and so are we. This is where we are called to be. This is where we are called to be. This land is holy, and so are we. This land is holy, and so are we. This land is holy, and so are we. This is where we are called to be. This is where we are called to be. The storm is raging, and so are we. The storm is raging, and so are we. The storm is raging, and so are we. This is where we are called. This is where we are called to be. The sun is shining, and so are we. The sun is shining, and so are we. The sun is shining, and so are we. This is where we are called to be. This is where we are called to be. The world is ready, and so are we. The world is ready, and so are we. The world is ready, and so are we. This is where we are called to be. This is where we are called to be. This is where we are called to be.
Do you need a thousand?
And now we're going to unmute folks as fast as we can. Ask to unmute, ask to unmute, ask to unmute. We had a lot of questions. Let me see.
Phil, one question was when, if a recording will be sent out. So,
yes, and it will. It'll be posted on the Eventbrite under details. Yes. Anybody have the? There are a lot of questions I could be asking from the chat. But does anyone have some other questions they'd like to ask out loud now? Smaller group.
Looks like Gail raised her hand.
Oh, good. Yeah, please just speak up. Excuse me. Sorry.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask, are we going, for people who registered, so you have our email addresses, will you be sending out an email with like a lot of the information here, like the, where the recordings are and where the everything is that we've done?
That would be easy to do, and we'll send the rich information slide as well, so that even people who weren't here get it.
Thank you.
Okay. But the recording information is also on, is also at Eventbrite. So, but I will send out a notice with that, with especially that slide in it. It's really very valuable. As someone said in their, or several people said on their way out in the chat room, a lot of actionable information today. And thank you, Ken.
Could I ask Ken a question?
Sure.
Ken, just today, this must have been fate. I was showing this guy my EV, Chevy Bolt, 2019. And he asked two things. He said, well, you know, when you're charging it off the grid, you know, what percentage of the electricity is green? And you seem to answer that almost about 50. And then he said, well, how many miles would a gasoline car, mileage per gallon, have to get before it is producing more emissions than an EV car running on the standard grid mix?
Yeah, good question. I know that Chevy Bolt has, I think, mile per gallon equivalent of 105. So right off the bat, I think, an internal combustion engine vehicle would have to get 105 miles to the gallon to match. So I think that's basically the answer.
Oh, no, I don't think that's what he was asking, not the cost. He was saying to the emissions produced, the EV is, right, you know, isn't totally zero emissions if the electricity is 50%, you know, dirty. And how much emissions comparably does the gas car produce? If it got 200 miles to the gallon, you know, maybe then its emissions would even be less than a car running on a 50% dirty grid. So it's an interesting question.
Yeah, I mean, the short answer is, I don't know, but that's a really fascinating question.
Me either.
I will say that not only is the grid, you know, roughly 50% non-emitting and getting better all the time, but EVs are way more efficient at converting electricity into forward momentum than internal combustion engine vehicles are. More than half of every gallon of gas burned in an internal combustion engine vehicle is lost as just heat, just waste heat, whereas almost all of the electricity in an EV goes towards actually powering the vehicle, just way more efficient.
If I could just add to that, and that is that there's a lot more than just the emissions from burning the gasoline when you're driving a gasoline engine car. There's an enormous amount of energy in creating the gasoline and transporting the gasoline. And so it's a lot worse than just the emissions of that the car is emitting driving down the road. It's a complicated calculation because there's so many variables: what kind of electric car, what kind of gasoline car, what kind of electricity you're using. So it's not hard to it's not easy to calculate.
Right.
But the ideal is, as we have using 100% renewable electricity, we know we're not emitting anything in terms of operating.
Yeah.
Yep.
Anybody else have something they want to share or ask? I know there were some. John Brown.
It looks like Cynthia has something.
Cynthia.
I only going to ask mine if we don't have some other things happening.
All right. I just have a question about the community solar. So I tried to get solar panels on my roof, and it's too shady here, and it's frankly town trees. And I can certainly go to the, you know, you gave me the link to the community solar, but I'm just curious, do many people use that in Winchester? I am, you know, 100% wind power in my home. So yep. I've done that, but I'd like to do more solar too.
Yeah, if you're already 100% wind power, if you're on the Wind Power 100 program, technically, all your you've essentially crossed the finish line already. Your electricity is all coming from wind and solar already. I think, I probably wouldn't do both. It wouldn't cause anything bad to happen. It would just be that it adds complexity to your life, and you're already. You know,
so it doesn't help with heating water or something like that.
No, because community solar is you know offsite, often in a different town. So you're not using it on if you had either photovoltaic panels on the roof or solar hot water panels, that is a great thing to do. Even if you're participating in Wind Power 100. But community solar kind of feels like sort of it's one of the either do community solar or wind power. It wouldn't really make sense to do both.
Okay, thanks.
If I could comment on that also, because I looked into that, we are already subscribing to 100% renewable. So it seems like logically, well, how can you do more? The problem is you're not, if people think they're buying electrons through the, you know, for their house, that sort of leads you astray. What you're really doing is you are paying for renewable goodness to happen somewhere. So you can actually be having 100% renewable electricity, and you could have community solar. You would probably be paying a bit more as you're doing that, but you'd be supporting the generation of more renewable energy. Now, I haven't done it myself yet, and it's I don't know anyone who actually has in Winchester, but it is possible, and it seems illogical, but it actually makes sense. You're just supporting more good stuff.
Ivan has a hand up.
Yeah, it's a fantastic presentation. I'm sorry I joined late. So the question I have is probably a little naive, but I was reading something about the Netherlands where they return energy to the grid. In other words, you could be charged, fully charged, and you know, if you're working, for example, you could leave your car there, and I guess you return energy to the grid. What is that concept? Because I almost feel that seems like the appropriate direction to be heading, where you know, if you're not using stuff up, you can actually assist in feeding stuff back into the grid. Could you explain that a little bit?
Yeah, I think that's coming in Massachusetts. It's greatly facilitated. You essentially have to have two things. You have to have a bi-directional electric vehicle charging station, which you can have on your house. You can purchase those already. But then you also have to have a way of sending that power back into the grid, almost as you do with excess solar power, if you have solar panels on your roof. And that requires a different kind of electric meter called a smart meter. The utilities have fought smart meters for a long time, but now they are coming. They have approval and they are going to be rolling them out. So essentially exactly what you're talking about, using your vehicle as a battery for your house and also to send extra electricity to the grid when during periods when the utilities really need it and are willing to pay you for it, that is coming. In fact, the new Ford F-150 Lightning that is coming out, I guess later this year, the more expensive of the two models will supposedly be able to power your house for like 3 days. So it's coming fairly quickly, and it's going to be a pretty valuable addition for home resilience and also grid services.
Thank you.
Yeah. It looks like Valerie has her hand up. But you're muted.
There yes, you. Hi. I thank you very much for your presentation. I have been fantasizing, not getting it done, about trying to get my town to do something like Winchester has done. And I thought that your slides were great. The first slides where you talked about we did this and we did this and we did that and we did this. That would be sort of things I could show them. Can we do this? Can we do this? Can we do this? And I did want to make sure that you said you were going to send the slides and I'd like to have them so that yes. I can maybe show them to a few people and say, can we do this too? Because I mean, it's great to hear.
Yeah. Well, two things about that. First, Phil, I will send my slides to you in a PDF if it's possible for you to send them out to everyone. I think that would be great, and I'm totally fine with that. The second thing is, I guess, Valerie, a suggestion would be, in a community that hasn't really gone down this road yet, success sells. So if you start with something small and easy, that's kind of an easy win and that makes people feel good about participating. Getting an energy audit for your municipal buildings, for example, and then, easy low hanging fruit, like, swapping out incandescent lights for LEDs or something like that, that will have a definite and short, payback, that kind of can build momentum because it'll buff up your reputation as someone who makes good things happen, and then people will feel good about it. You can have ribbon cutting during some of these things. The politicians get involved. That then makes it possible to do increasingly difficult things because you have that sense of momentum. So just a suggestion on that.
Great. We are a green community, I think, and I was thinking that aggregation thing would be a good thing to try to get going, but I don't know if we'd get any 100% people in my town, but anyway.
Well, even if you start small, that's also a kind of a no-brainer because you're signing longer contracts for your electricity supply. Even if you only had an extra 5% renewable electricity, you'd usually be beating the utility rates. So you're essentially saving people money and getting more renewable electricity. It's kind of almost an automatic win-win at the low levels of extra renewables.
Yeah, like Boston does that. I've no. Yeah, right. Okay, yep. Cool. Yep. Yeah, great.
Yep.
Thanks.
Sure. I don't see any other hands up right now, but happy to answer other questions. Don't be shy. John, are you trying to
wait? Sorry, I have to unmute. Okay, sorry. Yes. Okay. Well, I didn't think you would stay on this long but anyway, as long as you're willing, then I'll go to my question. My understanding is that there was that smart program or something, which was one in your timeline, trying to get people to get heat pumps. Although that was, satisfying Arlington and Winchester, my understanding is that there really weren't a whole lot of people who actually signed up at that time. And I'm thinking that part of that may be because of the price of electricity versus the price of gas. And I've heard people say they've had it priced out. And even after putting the upfront money to, converting a heat pump, which is, you know, many thousands of dollars, which may be subsidized, whatever. Even after that, when they're running their electric heat pump, the electricity is costing more than the gas that they were burning before without even having to do any upgrade. So I'm wondering if to what extent that's true and to what extent you think that's an impediment. And then finally, you know, looking at the big picture, to what extent it would make a change if we had a price on carbon.
Yeah, price on carbon would change a lot and a lot for the better. But I'll unpack what you're talking about. So the cost of converting a home to heat pumps can be significant depending on the house. Again, if you do already have ductwork for forced hot air or central AC, the cost is actually quite reasonable. It's sort of the cost of almost the same price as just replacing your compressor, your outdoor compressor. If you don't have ductwork, that's when it can become significantly expensive, which is why I'm hoping that someone like Mitsubishi comes up with an air-to-water heat pump solution that you can just use to replace your boiler. I think that's coming. On the point of electricity versus other fuels, you will definitely, therm to therm for your home. You will save money if you're using propane heat and go to electric heat pump. You'll save money if you're using oil heat. It's more or less break even if you're already using gas. I think to heat your home with an air source heat pump, the data I've seen is that on average, you usually pay a little bit more, not a lot more, but a little bit more, maybe, 2, 3, 4% more to heat with a heat pump. A lot of it depends on how well insulated and air sealed your house is and so on and so forth. That's for an existing older home. New construction, it's easy to make super tight envelope and have very low heating costs that are really comparable with natural gas.
And if you have a ground source heat pump, then you'll come out ahead, right?
Yeah, operating expenses for ground source are superior to natural gas, but of course the upfront cost is higher. So let's see, two more hands up. I don't know which one. I don't know, Phil, if you were watching, who?
I'm watching.
Roseanne.
I think Phil.
Sorry. I'm sorry, that was me.
I think
Roseanne,
Valerie.
There we go.
I think Valerie had hers up first, but I'm not sure if it's left over from before.
Oh, it went
down.
Yep,
she just raised her hand down. This might be a dumb question. On the heat pumps, so say Mitsubishi is able to come out with one that you're able to replace your boiler with. So my gas boiler currently heats my garage. If it was replaced with a heat pump, does a heat pump give off heat as well, like a boiler does?
They don't have it yet, but it depends where the compressor unit is. If it is the condenser unit, if it is inside your house, it really couldn't be actually. I think it would need to be outside. So I think the short answer is it would not. The unit itself would not give off heat into the space around it.
Yeah.
You'd have to add some kind of fan coils or something like that.
Okay.
Or extra radiator in the space you want to heat.
Yep. Thanks.
By the way, we are about to end, but I want to reassure you that Ken and I have already talked about the tremendous interest in really understanding the economics and logistics of heat pumps. And we're thinking of having a special community-wide meeting that's just focused on that with a panel of folks, including, Ken and a contractor or two, and some people with their own personal experience they want to share. So that's something that really came out of the questions that started last week on the same issue. And thank you much. Thank you very much, everybody. And I'm going to say good night. And come next week, please. You'll hear more good things. Goodbye. Thanks, Ken.
Thanks so much. This was great. I enjoyed it. Good night, everybody.
Good night. Thank you.